The Bloody Christmas of 1963. It opened great wounds between the two societies in Cyprus. In the next 10 years, this small village in the northern part of the island became a lifeline for Turkish Cypriots who were trying to survive. And many Turkish Cypriots took refuge here in Erenköy and tried to get organized. And soon, Erenköy became the symbol of Turkish Cypriot resistance.
Bayrak Erenköy'den gelmiştir, 63 seneliktir. Onu gözüm gibi bakarım, yırtılmamak için. Korkma, sönmez bu şafaklarda yüzen alsancak. Sönmeden yurdumun üstünde en son ocak. O benim milletimindir ancak.
The year of 1964 began with renewed attacks against Turkish Cypriots. Turkish towns outside of Nicosia turned into front lines. Erenköy, known in Greek as Kokina, was one of them.
15 Şubat'ta Rumlar geldi bize, köyün batısında Dikili Dağ, Aşdere dediğimiz bir yer vardı. Geldiler orada, köyü ateş altına aldılar. İlk çarpışmamız gece vakti. Yani gelişi güzel atarlardı köyün içine yani. Yani bütün gece attılar. Biz ilk defa olduğu için karşılık veremedik. Yani bir otomatik tüfeğimiz vardı, iki lasitten. Mücahitler şaşırdı, ateş bile edemedik. İkinci gece gene geldiler yani oraya. Bu defa ben bir mevzi yaptırdım, otomatik tüfeği koydum, ateş ettikleri yeri. Geldiler gene başladılar köye ateş açmaya. Mütemadiyen. Otomatik tüfekle ateş açtık biz de genlere devamlı.
From April the 1st, Turkish reinforcements began arriving on the Erenköy coast. They were not a real army, but young Turkish Cypriots in diaspora rushed to defend Erenköy.
Turkish Cypriots were really suffering on the island. I mean, I was a student in 1963 in Turkey. And when the Greek Cypriots attack started, I and other Turkish Cypriot students studying in Turkey, we got together and we pressurized the Turkish government to equip us with arms and ammunition to come to the island to help our community. And I was in the group, 500 students eventually managed to get organized. And we ended up in Erenköy in the far west of the TRNC today, and we managed to get in arms and ammunition to the fighters on the island.
Köylüler mayolarını giyiyorlar ve mayolarını giydikten sonra denize giriyorlar, bizi sırtlanıyorlar, dışarıya çıkıyorlar, daha sonra da mühimmatı çıkarıyorlar. Bizler o akşam camide yatıyoruz, bir battaniye veriyorlar bize, yarısı alttan yarısı üstten orada yatıyoruz. Sabahleyin caminin avlusunda toplanıyoruz içtimaya ve beşer kişilik mangalara ayrılıyoruz ve Mansura, Bozda, Alev Kayası, Selçuklu köylerine, bu dört köye 5-5 dağıtılıyoruz oradaki mücahitlere takviye olarak. Tabii bizler bu 535 üniversite genci, silah bol, cephane bol, Hepimiz birer aslan kaplan gibindik. Zaten hepimiz arzulu olarak geldik, hiçbir baskı altında kalmadan gelmiştik. Erenköy'e gelen, peyderpey gelen öğrencilerin ilk durak yeri burasıydı. Burada yatıyorduk, ondan sonra mevzilere aktarılıyorduk.
Erenköy was one of the last port areas under Turkish Cypriot control. It had been a vital supply link to transfer much-needed weaponry from Turkey. The shipment of arms was initiated by local people called Bereketçiler. In August 1958, three young men made the first journey using small rowboats.
Abi Masaf, arkadaşı Vehbi Mahmut ve dayımın oğlu Cevdet Remzi. Gittiler, aldılar sandalı, gittiler, çıktılar Türkiye'ye. Aldılar günleri, Mersin'e getirdiler, dıktılar içeri, kaçaktılar diye. Biz kaçak değiliz diyor. Rumlar silahlandı, bizi öldürmeye başladı, silah getirmeye geldik. Türkiye'de doktor Burhan Nalbantoğlu vardı, oradaydı, orada kısıldı. Üniversitedeydi, okurdu, ne bileyim, onu tanırlardı. Onu getirdiler, o da olur verdi genlere, bunlar emin insanlardır. Silahları verirsek istediğimiz yere getirirler. Onun için bıraktılar genleri. Verdiler yine, sandalı doldurdular, verdiler silahları, getirdiler ilk yolculuk. Gelince onlar artık resmen başladı silah ikmali Türkiye'den. Devamlı gider gelirlerdi tabii, çok yol yaptılar. Bu yolları yaparken çok tehlikeliydi çünkü İngilizler devriye gezerdi gemilerle. Fırtına tutardı. Yani bizimkiler beklerdi, takip ederdi. O İngilizlerin destroyeri vardı, geçerdi bizim köyden, devamlı kontrol ederdi. Takip ederdi, ne zaman gelmez, o gece giderlerdi Türkiye'ye ve getirirlerdi silahları.
Later on, the Turkish and Turkish Cypriot authorities started using the port for regular clandestine arms shipments. For the Greek Cypriot authorities, Erenköy was a threat. This lifeline between Turkey and Turkish Cypriots had to be cut off. In 1964, General Yorgo Grivas returned to Cyprus to take over the supreme command of all Greek forces on the island. Greece deployed thousands of troops equipped with heavy weaponry.
Yer yer ateş tiyatileri oluyor, saldırılar oluyor ve şehitler veriyorduk. Tabii Rum hükümeti Erenköy'de Türk askeri olduğuna kanaat getiriyor ve 64 yıllarında adaya gelen barış gücü askerleri de bu bölgede görev yapanlar vardı. Bizden onlara haber, onlardan bize haber getiriyorlardı. Ve en son getirdikleri haberde Rumların Ağustos ayının ilk haftalarında taarruza geçecekler. Siz burada azlıksınız, silah gücünüz azdır. Ne olur zayiat vereceksiniz, fazla teslim olun. Bu gibi söyleşilerde bulunuyorlardı ve takriben 11 bin, 12 bin tam teçhizatlı, zırhlı araçlarla size saldıracaklar. Siz 700 kişi bu silahlarla ne yapacaksınız? Teslim olun. Bizler hayır, canımızın çarptığı sürece biz teslim olmayız.
Hopes for peace were waning. Britain once again gathered all parties including Turkey and Greece in London. While the conference was underway, the situation in Cyprus began to deteriorate with clashes taking place in various parts of the island. In February of 1964, Greek forces attacked the town of Limassol. Their atrocities were covered by mainstream newspapers for the whole world to see. Turkey was furious.
Well, I was there as my father was consul general. He went there in the good times, 1961. And it was a wonderful time then. The Greeks and the Turks were intermingling. And then after the first 1963, after the attacks happened in Cyprus, we had the big demonstrations in Istanbul, gigantic demonstrations. I remember I went to see what was going on, what was going there with some friends of mine. My father got very angry that I exposed myself, but they were very, I haven't seen such demonstrations before in Turkey. And we had security of the consulate that was on Rahamam Sokak at the time. And it was, but the population was quite afraid. And then, of course, in 1964, we had the cancellation of the bilateral agreement of Greece and Turkey on, it was a friendship agreement by which Greek nationals were allowed to live in Turkey and to work in Turkey.
In March, a UN peacekeeping force was deployed to Cyprus, but was unable to improve the situation. In response to continuing violence, Ankara decided to intervene. Britain and the United States were scrambling to prevent a Turkish military operation. Then US President Lyndon Johnson took an unexpected approach. On the 5th of June, Johnson sent a strongly worded letter to Turkish Prime Minister İsmet İnönü. He was almost threatening that the US would not stand beside Turkey in the event of a Soviet invasion of Turkish territory. Turkish troops were already on the move, but the intervention was called off. The Johnson letter caused not just a political, but also a public outrage and would have a lasting impact on Turkish-American relations for years to come.
It was Britain, remember, that brought America into the Balkans with the Truman Doctrine in 1946-47. And by that time, Greece and Turkey had joined NATO, and again, it was the Russian obsession which dictated events for the Americans. So although in the late 50s, America had said for Cyprus, we need a long-term modus vivendi, which in a way is what you've got now, with no clarity and real diplomatic talks. And that's what happened. American involvement increased and increased and increased, and British involvement got less and less and less.
Well, it's clear that the Americans were the only power that could broker a deal between Greece and Turkey, as well as the Cypriot sides. That increasingly became evident when the British system broke down after 1963. And the United Nations had to intervene. But as I just mentioned, the United Nations also was ineffective at mediating a settlement. So the Americans naturally got involved at that point. And when things got out of hand, the Americans had to play the role of judge, jury, and executioner. And at that point, President Johnson basically told Turkey that intervention shouldn't occur.
Soon after, U.S. President Johnson invited İsmet İnönü and Greek Prime Minister Yorgo Papandreou to Washington for talks. There, the U.S. vowed to continue to recognize the 1959 agreements over Cyprus. But by that point, those agreements had little effect in reality. The power-sharing constitution had fallen apart following the bloody Christmas of 1963. The republic's structure was changed unilaterally by Makarios. Enosis was already a Greek national policy and would not be abandoned. For Turkish Cypriots, the Cyprus government had lost its legitimacy, and they formed their own de facto administration.
After 1963, the two sides, the Greek Cypriots having usurped the Republic of Cyprus, developed their own administration. So the community turned into an administration of their own, 100% Greek Cypriot. And the Turkish Cypriots, although they were confined to nearly 3.5% of the island in small areas that were protected by the Turkish fighters, we formed our own administration and we formed our own defense forces. Therefore, from 1963 onwards, we were no more communities, we were administrations.
Meanwhile, in Erenköy, Greek forces were closing in. Ankara had to take steps. On the 31st of July, Turkish Colonel Rıza Vuruşkan arrived in Erenköy. He was accompanied by the Turkish Cypriot leader Rauf Denktaş and the last group of students who signed up as reinforcements. On the 6th of August, Grivas attacked a nearby area and surrounded the village. Colonel Vuruşkan had to order a retreat.
Bir gecede hepsini boşalttık, diğer dört köy. Erenköy'e yerleşti. Bütün halk yani bıraktı her şeyini, mücahitler de. Gece geldi, Erenköy'ün etrafını çepeçevre savunmaya aldık artık. Rumlar bekledi mesela, diğer gün bakar ses yok diğer köylerden. Yavaş yavaş girdiler köye ama yoktu hiçbir, ne mücahit ne hiç. Ve Erenköy'ün etrafını sardılar, denize döksünler bizi. Hatta BAF tarafından otobüsler, sivil otobüsler doldu, gelsin seyretsin bizi ki denize döküleceğiz.
...8 Ağustos sabahı da Rumlar Mansura tarafından, doğudan, batıdan, Başınamo tarafından, denizden de 4 tane hücum bot, karadan ve denizden bizi abluka altına alıyorlar. Rıza Vuruşkan o eski filmlerde görülen manyetolu telefonlarla bütün mevzilere tepli yayınlıyor. Çocuklar, kaçacak yerimiz yoktur. Her taraftan sarıldık, denizden, karadan sarıldık. Bir mermiyi kendinize saklayın ve canınızın çarptığı zerresine kadar mücadeleye devam. Öyle de ölüm, böyle de ölüm. Bizler birbirimizle kucaklaşıyoruz. Birer mermiyi isabetli bir yerimize koyuyoruz ve can havliyle çarpışıyoruz. Atılan mermiler o kadar çoktu ki havada böyle arı nasıl oğul çıkarır, gölge yapıyordu mermiler.
The Greek side was ready and well equipped for an all-out war. The Turkish Cypriot troops were outpowered and lacking supplies. They were barely able to hold their positions until the 8th of August. Turkey could no longer tolerate it.
Denktaş Bey bu bağıradan genelkurmaylıkla irtibat kuruyor ve genelkurmaya adeta yalvarırcasına ne olur bir an evvel gelin, uçaklar gelmezse hepimiz şehit olacağız. Belli ki olumsuz bir haber gelmiş olur kendisine ki şu sözü kullanır en son. Eğer Türkiye müçbir bir sebepten dolayı gelemeyecekse vatan sağ olsun diyor ve telsizi kapatıyor. Ve iki dakika sonra Rıza Vuruşkan'ı buraya bu telsize çağırıyorlar. Rıza Vuruşkan geliyor, iki dakika bu telsiz cihazıyla görüşme yapıyor. Hemen dışarıya kollarını açarak fırlıyor dışarıya ve büyük bir heyecanla geliyorlar, geliyorlar diyor. Ve yine o eski filmlerde gördüğümüz manyetolu telefonlarla bütün cephelere mesaj yayınlıyor. Diyor ki çocuklar gözünüz aydın, uçaklarımız geliyor. Mevzilerinizin önüne beyaz işaret bezleri koyun ki sınırlarımız belli olsun. Bizler de don, atlet, beyaz bezler de bulacağız. Ne varsa çıkarıp koyuyoruz. Ve bu arada 4 tane F-104 uçağı geliyor.
The first flight of jets arrived around 4:15 p.m. local time. They flew over the region to assess the situation. Soon, dozens more jets would appear and start bombarding Greek positions. The Greeks were also targeting Turkish positions and air defense. Turkish pilot Cengiz Topel was leading a four-fighter flight when his aircraft was shot from a Greek patrol boat.
Cengiz Topel paraşüt açıldı.
sallana sallana indi asfaltın içine. Şimdiki büstünün olduğu yerin hemen asfalt kısmından X oraya tarafa, gemi konana doğru bir 20-30 metre kadar bir şey. Tam böyle şey, bir dere gibi bir yer var orada. Ve toprak yığınının köşesi düştüğü yer. Ben oradan koşa koşa karargahıma geldim. Bir 50 metre var. Hemen telefonu aldım. Komutana, komutanım pilotumuz indi falan noktada. Gayet güzel bir yaklaşma istikameti var. Benden, yani benim mevzimden, Cengiz Köy'de de benim mevzilerim var, nöbetçilerim var. En fazla, hadi bilelim, 1 kilometre bir mesafe var. Gidip alacağım. Genç komutan, sakin ol, heyecanlanma. Kartallar Musava'da uçarken bize iş düşmez, dedi komutanım. Sakinledim tabii. Hakikaten de kartallarımız uçar havada. Aşağı yukarı bir 20-30, yarım saat olmadı yani. Bir araba geldi. Pilotumuz indi, yolda yön tespit etmeye çalıştı herhalde. Bir araba geldi. Bir badire oldu olmadı gibi bazı hareketler derken aldılar, gittiler. Rumlar geldi, aldı.
Cengiz Topel got out of his burning aircraft alive, but he was captured by Greek Cypriot National Guard. It took 4 days for his body to be returned to the Turkish authorities only after insistent attempts. He was brutally tortured to death.
O derece bir insanlık dışı, bir ezilme, bir insanlık, bunlarda vatan, insanlık kalmadı. Hiçbir tırnakları söküldü, bütün kolu kırıldı ve her tarafı mosmor ve yara ezilmiş. Yani o insanlık için yapılan, ölünceye kadar, öldürünceye kadar olan eziyetlerin içinde infial, isyan etmemek, bağırmamak günlerce ağladım. Hala da canlı gözümün önündedir Cengiz Topel.
Fighting continued in Erenköy the next day until a UN Security Council resolution managed to get the sites to cease the fire. UN forces were once again deployed to the area. Erenköy residents were no longer threatened by Greek forces, but their struggle was not over.
Yardımlar gelmeye başladı. Battaniyeler, yataklar bilmem ne. Yerleştirdik yani o göçmenleri. Bazısı mağarada kaldı, çoğu mağarada kaldı. Daha emniyetlidir diye. Ama kışta çok zordu. Çadırlar, rüzgar uçurdurdu çadırları. Bütün gece insan var, bütün gece direkleri tutardı çadırların sırf uçması. Zor günler geçirdik yani. Geldi mesela barış gücü komutanı ziyaret etti çadırları. Gördü ki perişanlık var, şey var, ekmek yok. Badadezleri fırına koyduk, ekmek yerine yerdik. Yani bir ekmeği 30 kişiye pay ederdik.
The violence in 1963 and 64 killed 364 Turkish and 174 Greek Cypriots. 109 Turkish and mixed villages were evacuated.
Türk bölgeleri tamamen Rum ablukasındaydı. Yani dört bir tarafı Rumlardan çevrilmiş. Düşünün ki biz bir adada yaşarız ve ben 63-74 arası denize gidemedim. Çünkü etrafımız dört bir taraftan Rumlar ile çevrilmiş idi. Değilim ki Lefkoşa'dan Magosa'ya veyahut İskele'ye gitmek zorundasın. Ailen var orada da, onları görmek isten. Binersin arabana veyahut otobüse. Yolda giderken kaybolursun. Veyahut barikatlarda dayak yersin. Sorguya çekilirsin. Bu şekilde geçen yıllar başladı. Baskı altında, zulüm altında, ölüm tehdidi altında.
Turkish Cypriots were isolated. EOKA kept checkpoints around Turkish enclaves. Turkish Cypriots depended on supplies from Turkey to stay alive.
Yanılmıyorsam her 6 ayda bir gemi şey gönderirdi bize. Gıda. 10 çeşit, 20 çeşit, daha fazla emin değilim. Yani un, şeker, şey, fasulye, bakliyat, ne bileyim ben, pastırma, sucuk, giyim, paltosu. Ve Rum hükümeti bize en büyük kalleşliği, yani Kızılay yardımı düşünün. Kızılay yardım gönderiyor ve Rum hükümetine biz gümrük ödeyerek alabiliyorduk o şeyi. Çekebiliyorduk gümrükten o malzemeyi.
In the meantime, another crisis, this time a political one, was brewing in Greece. On April 21st, 1967, a coup d'etat ousted the government in Athens and started to destabilize Cyprus. Grivas was in charge once again with the blessings of the junta in Athens. The Greek junta was in need of public approval, and achieving enosis seemed to be the easiest way to get it. On November 15th, Greek Cypriot National Guard, led by Grivas, overran two remaining Turkish enclaves in the south, Boğaziçi and Geçitkale. 27 people were killed. The incident led to a Turkish ultimatum to Greece, once again pushing the two countries to the brink of war. The Greek junta complied by pulling out its troops and General Grivas back to Greece.
The Greek Cypriots overplayed their hand. In particular, Grivas instigated a confrontation over what we call Erenköy, and that led to the threat of Turkish intervention on Cyprus, and it changed the balance of power. This reality on the ground weakened Makarios's hand at the negotiating table. So after 1967, we see that the Greek Cypriot position becomes more open to Turkish Cypriot political equality or some kind of accommodation. That accommodation continued from 1968 to 1974 with on and off rounds of negotiation between delegates of the Turkish Cypriot leader and the Greek Cypriot leader, namely Mr. Denktaş and Mr. Kleridis. But they couldn't agree on a final settlement, and then 1974 occurred.
Makarios was re-elected president in 1968 by an overwhelming majority and won again in 1973. But there was a growing opposition against him because of his softer approach to enosis. Makarios survived several assassination attempts, and the Greek junta was his biggest enemy. On July 15, 1974, they finally toppled him.
What do you want the United Nations to do?
We condemn for violation of the independence of Cyprus by the Greek junta, and to ask the Greek military regime to withdraw from Cyprus the Greek officers.
In 1974, Makarios pursued the line that if they tried to unite the island, Turkey would intervene, and he tried to use indirect ways of getting rid of the Turkish Cypriots, like, for example, giving Turkish Cypriots tickets to go overseas, young Turkish Cypriots, go to Australia, there's a better life there. They go to the UK, there's a better life there, and encourage Turkish Cypriots to leave the island and impose restrictions on Turkish Cypriots so that with the suffering, they would give up their fight against the Greek Cypriots. It didn't happen. So when the Greek junta in Athens said that this is enough, this policy is not enough, Makarios is not achieving enosis on the island, we are going to do a military operation against Makarios and unite the island with Greece militarily. So this happened on the 15th of July. And Makarios was taken down. Makarios was attempted to kill him, but he managed to escape. He went to New York on the 19th of July, 1974. He said in the Security Council that Greece is invading the island. I mean, this is on public records.
The Greek junta installed Nikos Samson as the president of Cyprus. He was the infamous commander who led the 1963 massacre on Turkish Cypriots in Küçükkaymaklı and was dubbed as the Butcher of Turks. In his first public address as president, Samson declared that the island's union with Greece had begun.
So from 15 July to 20 July, there was great anticipation of what was about to happen. I mean, I was alive at the time, that tells you my age. And I remember my grandfather listening very intently to the radio for any news whatsoever. We had our Mujahid, the Turkish Cypriots, who were in the streets, but many Turkish Cypriots were also enclaved. So there was great fear in the Turkish Cypriot community. And of course, there was fighting and killings in the Greek Cypriot community. So eventually, Turkish Cypriots' only hope was a Turkish intervention.
Days following the coup were unbearable for Turkish Cypriots. They were in fear and despair. But the wait ended on the fifth day. On the 20th of July 1974, the radio started to play the song that Turkish Cypriots had been waiting for so long. Finally, the Turkish army landed on the island.